So as the gender gap in most Philippine organizations narrowing, that is a question. What are the opportunities out there for women to take on leadership roles? With us in the studio this afternoon to talk about gender gap and more, women leaders are Imaginable Impact CEO Nina Terol and COO Candice Kimpo. Ladies, thank you so much for being on the Business Roadshow.
All right, good afternoon, and thank you so much, Stanley.
It's good to have you here. Let's first talk about the gender gap. Is there a gender gap still in this day and age?
There's very much so a gender gap in this day and age. I think even with a lot of efforts in trying to be more inclusive in all fields, we're still feeling what it means to be on the other side of things as women. And it's really interesting because we do rank pretty well when it goes to gender surveys around the world. And I think anecdotally, we all feel that we're very matriarchal. We love our moms. We see a lot of women leaders. But in the business side of things, in corporates, in C-suites, in investment, you know, deal flows, we're not seeing that gap being closed quite yet.
And do you think that is intentional, or is it part of the culture? What might be the causes behind it?
Well, it's multifaceted. So definitely, we don't think it's intentional. Nobody would say that they are actively edging women out, right? And in fact, I think there are now more more movements towards diversity, equity, and inclusion in the workplace. However, we would see that unconscious biases still exist around us. So there are a number of factors, whether it's cultural, you know, women still carry a lot of the burden of or the load of caring for households, caring for parents. So there are a lot of barriers that still keep them from rising above professionally. But there are also a lot of systemic changes that still need to happen for women to really be able to, I guess, step up to their power and be able to lead in organizations, especially in business.
And what has changed in the Philippine scenario?
We do have a lot of women leaders right now that we're seeing. You see it every month, every March on Women's Month, right? All the lists of powerful women here and there. So there is a rise. There is a culture, especially with the millennials and Gen Z really leading the way here. And so the numbers are rising, but again, still not enough. What's really interesting is I think we're witnessing a conversation that's shifting from the battle of the sexes to really about an inclusion you know, movement. We really need to think about it as a diversity intention and not a, you know, because you're a man and I'm a woman, we're going to battle it out and see who's the best. It's really what's good for everyone is everyone gets represented.
Okay, and this, of course, is encapsulated in Imaginable Impact, your organization. Tell us about it.
Yeah, so Imaginable Impact is an inclusion studio. We design programs, events, and projects that help co-create a more diverse and inclusive world. And for us, also coming from the lens of women, we're here to create a world where women thrive, especially in business, especially in the workplace. And we're really excited about the work that we're doing with women entrepreneurs and women startup founders in particular.
How has the experience been for you with Imaginable Impact, giving and opening up all of these opportunities for a lot of women who want to start a business or to excel in an organization or even in startups?
So what we've been doing really for the past several months is holding a lot of conversations both on the founder side and on the investor side and really listening to what their pain points might be that won't come out, let's say, in an FGD or a news article, right, or a survey. And what we're hearing is really a desire, like women are really out there trying to change things, but they're met with, you know, what she's saying, like there's a lot of systemic changes that need to happen. So culturally, they feel like the bias against them is still present. But when you talk to men, especially male investors, they're willing to change and they're not aware of these bias. So what's happening is that the conversation is growing. And I think there are more people trying to be involved here. It's just really a question of what do we do now? And for us, it really means like we just need to ask more questions and not assume that the answers are all out there. It's just started.
Is there a way of gauging the impact of what you do? Women startups, for instance, can you give us an example perhaps or an experience you'd like to share?
Before the experience, right, globally, we're already seeing when you look at women-led startups, they're actually delivering more revenue, more than male-led startups. Okay. So we're seeing that trend happening. But there's a disparity on how much investment is being given to female-led startups. So the impact is once female-led startups actually do get the resources to build it, we're seeing a lot of female technology or femtech products coming out. We're seeing community-driven products coming out because the women's lens or the female lens is very different, and they're seeing problems that the more traditional startups are solving right now.
Mm-hmm. And so we're excited because right now there's really a big gap in terms of gender lens investing. So globally, only 2% of the world's venture capital goes to female-led startups. I mean, 2%, that's really tiny. So what we're also envisioning for our work is to see that number go up. We would like to see greater investments in female-led startups for women-led businesses to grow, create the impact that we want to make. So there are numbers, and we just need to also be able to track those numbers, have more conversations, and also show the investors and show the community that by investing in women-led businesses, we're actually investing in problems that need to be solved. So Candice mentioned some of them. There's a lot more that women are willing to do if they're given the resources to do so.
What about perceptions? Has mm-hmm. that changed now? I mean, are you seeing more supportive investors towards women yeah. startups? Based on your experience, how many years have you been in operation?
We're officially. Very new.
Very yeah. new.
Okay. Officially, we're...
Okay, but at least yeah. are you making an impact? Are you making headway and progress in terms yeah. of promoting women investors?
Officially, we're not a year old, but we've been in the startup industry in different capacities, and mm-hmm. we are seeing a change. I think the biggest change is intentionality. Okay. We've always wanted to... We're very collaborative as a culture, I think. We like working as a team. The Bayanihan thing, I think it's very strong. But mm-hmm. intentionality is so important because then you can create a roadmap. And in your, according to a lot of people that we've talked to, men and women, they are looking for female-led startups because they know what kind of impact they're going to have on revenue and business and the economy, both local and global. Mm-hmm. So we know it theoretically. So how do we bridge that now?
Yeah. What was the inspiration for both of you to get into this? Maybe Nina first.
Yeah, well, the inspiration, having come from the startup space and witnessing for myself, I was in a lot of pitch competitions. I was in a lot of the actual pitches. And I could really see that there were hardly any women yeah. on the investment side. So few women on the investment side also meant that the questions were very different, the conversations were very different. You know, when it's mostly an all boys club, sorry about yeah. the term, right? But that was the reality. And then also seeing pitch competitions and startup events, there were very few women for a while. So, but now that's changing, and the consciousness is also that we're now actively looking for more women to step up and also represent the sector.
And Candice?
Yeah, so I actually come from a communications and media background as well, so I'm a storyteller, and I listen to a lot of people. And my inclination really is to look at intersectional stories. So it's not just about being a woman, for example, if I listen to your story, but how is it being a woman in the urban poor, or if you're an immigrant, and all these things that come together that add up to the inequity that you're probably feeling at that point. So when you're an entrepreneur and you're a woman, it's not just really about, as I said, a gender situation, but it's so many things that happen. So what we want to do together, and what I'm really pushing forward, is how do we tell a fuller narrative of what it means to be a woman entrepreneur or a woman mm-hmm. founder? Mm-hmm. Because it's more than just hitting the revenues. Of course, that's what the investors want to know. But how do you even get to the point where you're ready to scale when you have children to take care of, or maybe a mom to take care of? Because that's mm-hmm. what we do. Right, the daughters, that's what we do. Or a lot of things that happen because as women, we have expectations that we were raised to have. Mm-hmm. How do we break those mindsets and
especially
barriers?
In the Philippines, I think we are.
Especially, but it's also really exciting because people are more vocal. We're very vocal. Okay. Mm-hmm. And I think if we just keep on talking about it and we have receptive people like you conversing with us instead of it being a one-way conversation, then change can happen faster.
Okay, and those conversations can be pushed in an upcoming summit, a forum, if you will, Found Her Forum happening next week. Tell us about the forum.
Yeah, so the Found Her Forum, it's our first public event. Actually, we've been on stealth mode the past few months, but this time we're super excited because we've gathered a really stellar lineup of startup founders, investors, startup leaders to talk about why should we invest in female founders and what makes a founder investable. So now for the first time, this ecosystem is gathering to talk about how can we move things forward, right? And for the female founders out there, how can they also have the courage, you know, the confidence, the competence and the knowledge and the networks to rise up and take on that path towards investability? So all of these are very important questions that are now being answered. And that's happening on Thursday, October 26, 2 to 5 p.m. at SM KMC North EDSA.
Okay, Candice, maybe some of the highlights. Who are expected to appear in the forum, and what are the key takeaways that participants may have or may have the privilege of listening to or digesting in that forum?
It's a really great mix. We're actually starting with a startup story by the co-founders of Kindred Health. They're a hybrid women's center.
Right. I think we've had them on the show.
They're amazing women.
Yes.
And
amazing
their growth is just really, you know, it's been tremendous. But not just that, is that they were able to do their fundraising in a, we want them to tell their story, basically, because if you have, what you can see, what you can imagine, you can do. That's really what storytelling does for you. But after that, then we have the ecosystem enablers and investors. We're starting with Kat Chan. She is the
executive director of Kubo Innovation Hub and Idea Space.
And then we're going to have an investor panel from different, like angel investors and venture capitalists and private equity, starting with Foxmont Capital Partners with Franco Verona. We're going to have Joseph De Leon of Manila Angels Investor Network, Raya
Buenceseso of Kaya Founders. Yeah, and then Nat Witayatana Seth of Findicate, and Haman Liao of Navigar. So representing different stages of the venture capital, I guess, or the funding life cycle, if you will.
Okay, and I'm sure this has been out. What kind of response have you been getting from a lot of women investors or women startups, perhaps? Have they been calling?
No, it's interesting because men and women alike are signing up for the event. So it also means that men are open to the conversation. They want to be part of it and they want to learn. So that's a good thing. We're going to have a really good mix. We also have guests signing up from the academe. So academe, startups, corporates, it's going to be a good mix.
And this is one day only?
It's one afternoon only.
One afternoon only, and is this a ticketed event?
It is a ticketed event. You can get our tickets from our website, imaginableimpact.com. It's really easy, you know, online purchase. And you know, held by a startup. You know, what's really interesting also is that we're getting a lot of questions about what else can we do about female founders. Mm-hmm. And the Founder Forum really challenges us to move from advocacy to action. And so by the end of, like, you know, by 5 p.m., we hope to have some kind of list or roadmap together as a community how we can empower and enable female-founded startups.
Yep. Let's talk about visions now. How do you envision your group to grow in the next couple of years? How do you see Imaginable Impact becoming a champion for women leaders, for women startups?
Wow, this is really exciting. Thanks for asking. So of course, this is only the first of many more forums, many more conversations. So we will be driving the conversation on investability, on growing businesses. And the important thing also is galvanizing a community. So with every event that we're doing, we're seeing that women want more. What happens next, right? So there's an opportunity to connect the dots and see where we can capacitate women with the knowledge, competency, and the network and the connections and the community to really move forward, because you can't do it alone. So we really will be working with the ecosystem.
Yeah, the main idea is really how do we create a platform as Imaginable Impact to lift women from idea or limited beliefs and then bring them into investability. So we're developing programs and products that will bridge that gap. Because sometimes it's really just that. There's like this gap, the gap, another gap, where it's really, you know, you want to do it, but because of culture or because of maybe a lack of knowledge, the knowledge
resources.
Is very technical, right? How do we bridge that so that we can have, imagine having the first Filipina unicorn coming very, very soon. That really is the dream, right? Mm-hmm. Still don't have it. And
we
hopefully we'll take
more.
Part.
Yes.
Yeah, we hope to take part in developing that Filipina unicorn.
All right. On that note, we thank you so much for being on the show today, Ninia Terol and Candice Kimpo, Imaginable Impact. We wish you well on the event
thank
next
you so
week.
Much.
Do come back on the show. Let's talk about the touch base, perhaps, and let's talk about how progress has been for you and your group.
All
thank
right.
you.
Thank you so much, Stanley.
Thank you.